or let me go to Delhi. Okay. So I don't know, you know, of course I'm not at all, you know, smart as the Buddha. Even the Buddha remained 49 days of silence, not giving teachings because of this complication as to how, you know, he discovered, you know, that things don't exist objectively. The profound experience he discovers is not that he invented. He didn't invent. He simply discovered the fact that while things appear to be so, you know, objectively appearing, but in reality, nothing exists objectively. Everything exists by the power of your mind, by the power of, you know, subjective imputation. Clear? Okay, so the Buddha remained 49 days of silence, and you are not giving even one day for me. Okay. Now, we go to Arunigarjuna's chapter 24. Now, what I'll do is that I have about 4 minutes. Maybe I will take another 10, 15 minutes extra, you know. I want to finish this text as soon as possible. Once we're done with this, then we can emphasize or stress more on the question answers. And then if possible, if you know, if I think that we have enough time, then we can do the emptiness part more extensively. Right. Okay. So you all have this one, the handout. Just raise your hands, those who have. Doesn't have that. Okay, you all have it. Okay, now from chapter 24 from Arunigarjuna's The Fundamental Wisdom of the Middle Way, Examination of the Four Noble Truths. Okay, so from stanza 1 to stanza 6, stanza 1 through the stanza 6 is the position of the non-Arunigarjuna's, the opponents of Arunigarjuna, right, their position. So from their position you will come to sense that, oh, you know, actually my, you know, although he's telling us to say that things don't exist objectively, but my take on the mode of existence is objective mode of existence, and this is exactly reflected here from stanza 1 through to stanza 6. So now what Arunigarjuna has to say? To reject it. Okay, this is what how we are following. And then chapter 7, stanza 7 is his summary of how he is going to reject, you know, the opponents believe that things are objectively existent. Okay, so now to give you, so I hope you have already read the synopsis which is distributed to you. If not, doesn't matter. I'm going to give a brief summary of that to give you a feedback, or not really feedback, I've got a background of, you know, these 6 stanzas, and then we read it, and then you will, you know, see that it's really very clear there. Otherwise, we read it and try to explain it, it's really time consuming and energy consuming. Okay, so stanza 1, it says, if all of this is empty, neither will arising nor ceasing exist. And for you, it follows that four noble truths would not exist. Okay. What is the difference between the dream and waking state? Yeah, realization. The dream pizza and the real pizza. What is the difference? The real pizza, if you eat, it can, you know, it can fulfill or it can eliminate your hunger. And the dream pizza, you eat it, it can't, you know, fulfill your hunger, eliminate your hunger. You agree with me or not?
Dream it fulfills.
Sorry?
You dream it fulfills.
No, because I have dreamt of, you know, not really having eaten pizzas, but I have dreamt of being so thirsty and drinking water, you know, and drinking water, you know, not really quench your thirst. Anyway, you know, so now to agree to avoid complication, let's say the dream pizza, you know, if you are to eat it now, it will not do the purpose of removing hunger. Whereas the real pizza, if you eat it, it will do the purpose of eliminating hunger. Why? In short, what I'm going to say is that, you know, the difference here is that one is in accord with the law of causation. You know, you eat and it serves as a cause, and the result is elimination of the hunger. So there's a, you know, the law of causation is applicable associated with the real pizza. But with the dream pizza, you know, imagine, oh, you're hungry? Really hungry? Oh yes, I'm really hungry. What do you want? Yes, I'll bring so much pizzas. And then imagine one pizza, two pizza, three pizza, you eat it. Oh, you know, do you think that this will remove your hunger? No. Imagine you're eating, you know, one pizza, two pizza, simply imagining. Simply on the level of imagination, you're doing it. In real sense, you are hungry. And you're imagining you are eating pizzas. Do you think that this will really eliminate your hunger? Generally speaking, no. Right. There could be exceptions, I don't know. But generally speaking, for a normal person, it will not. Which means that pizza is meant to remove your hunger. In order to accord with the law of causation, according to the law of causation, the pizza, by eating it, should be serving as a cause to give rise to the happiness of having no hunger. But this is not happening. Why? Okay, now the argument, the opponents of Aranigarjuna, you know, the opponents, they are raising is that if everything is objective, if nothing is objectively, if everything is subjectively existent, then it becomes your dream pizza. You know, then imagine you're so poor, but why should you be poor? There should be no poor person. You can think of, you know, your house filled with jewelries, money, dollars, all these things. Oh, you are rich. You know, it really defies the law of causation. So, if you want to eat apples, there should be someone planting, you know, apple seed. So this, the seed of the apple will grow to a shoot. So whereas, if the apple exists 100% subjectively, you know, then it needs not. You simply throw of it and the apple should arise. This means that it doesn't need, you know, the arising, the slow arising of the apple, you know, apple trees, slow growing, productions of apple, it is not necessary. So which means that if everything is 100% subjectively existent, there is no, you know, the arising existing. If there is no arising, there is no ceasing. Right? And imagine the Four Noble Truths. The Four Noble Truths is based on the concept of arising and ceasing. How? What is the first noble truth? The truth of suffering. What is the second noble truth? The truth of cause of suffering. The truth of cause of suffering in the form of afflictions and karmas, you know, they give rise to the suffering. So the suffering arises, you know, because of these, the second truth, the truth of the cause of suffering. If there is no arising, then the suffering is nowhere there. Because suffering should, Buddha said, not only Buddha said, in our personal experience, we see that the suffering arises because of the cause of the suffering. So if there is no arising, then the suffering does not exist. If the suffering is not there, then the causes of the suffering, they are not the cause of suffering. To say that something is a cause of suffering, there should be the suffering. Without suffering, how can you say that this is the cause of suffering? So, the suffering does not exist. The cause of suffering does not exist. If there is no suffering and there is no cause of suffering, why should we struggle? Why should we put so much effort in meditation, practice and so forth? You know, if there is no cause of suffering, if there is no suffering at all, then there is no nirvana. Nirvana is, you know, when you eliminate the causes of suffering and the suffering. When these are eliminated, only then you achieve nirvana. So the achieving of nirvana makes no sense if there is no arising. If there is no nirvana, there is no path leading to nirvana. This is for truth. So the lower schools, they are saying that if everything is subjectively existent, then you are denigrating or you are rejecting the law of, you know, the arising and degenerating or ceasing. If you disregard this phenomena of arising and degenerating, then you cannot account for the Four Noble Truths. And the Four Noble Truths, you know, it is on the basis of the Four Noble Truths, the practice of the Four Noble Truths, that, you know, that someone upgrades one's spiritual, you know, realization. Ordinary person, through the practice of the Four Noble Truths, you know, then gradually the person becomes more and more pure, you know, and then at one point, they become really Arya beings. Arya beings referring to those who see the ultimate reality directly, you know, which is a very advanced level. So the Arya beings, they are referred to as the Sangha members. And these Arya beings, through further spiritual maturation, they eventually become Buddha. So if there is no the Four Noble Truths, then the practice of Four Noble Truths becomes senseless. So without that, you know, someone becoming Aryas cannot be possible. If there is no Aryas, then someone perfecting the Arya level and becoming Buddha is also not possible. Which means that the Four Noble Truths cannot be posited, because of which the Dharma cannot be posited, because of which the practitioners of the Dharma cannot be posited, because of which the perfected person through the practice of this, which is the Buddha, is not possible. So three jewels you are denigrating, the Four Noble Truths you are denigrating, and also, you know, you say that, oh, now today at 6 o'clock we're going to have class, you know, at Chogur Sunling. Now, oh, I have to rush through. Why should you rush if everything is subjectively? Imagine you're in Chogur Sunling and you're already here, you know. So, but this is not the case. If you're far away from Chogur Sunling, you have to somehow get a bus, auto, or your car, or whatever you have to, you know, get some means with effort. Only you can get here. Whereas if everything is subjective, you know, why should you put all these efforts? You just imagine. Subjectively you imagine, I'm in Chogur Sunling. You know, but you're there. But this is not the case, which means that not only that, you know, you disregard or you denigrate the Four Noble Truths, you denigrate Buddha, Dharma, and Sangha, you also denigrate the ordinary mundane conventionalities. Why? So, oh, now we have learned about subjective existence. There is nothing existing objectively. Everything is subjectively existent. So far, I've been struggling so much to pay the bill for my, you know, house. Now I don't have to worry about it. You know, imagine this is my own house. Imagine food is there. I don't have to go to work. No, it doesn't work. It doesn't work that way. Which means that, you know, if everything is subjectively existent, then somehow all these absurdities you have to accept, which is totally senseless, you know, which means that if you still insist on that, you are denigrating, you are defying the conventionality of the world. This is the argument put forth by the, you know, opponents of Aranyagarjuna against Aranyagarjuna for his belief or for his philosophy that the ultimate reality of everything is the emptiness of particular existence. Okay, you got it. Now let's read this.